For the histochemical staining of cross-section samples, the workspace should be set up with micromesh for polishing the samples, various staining solutions and rinsing solutions and dishes, some tweezers, some small pieces of tissue paper, and a timer. To make sure that the sample has a perfectly smooth cross-section surface and it is clean without any fingerprints or other contamination on it, it is useful to repolish the sample just before starting the staining procedure. For this purpose, the finest grades of micromesh with grits of around 6,000 to 12,000 are used. After the polishing, the sample is mounted with plasticine on a glass slide to be examined under the microscope. The sample is adjusted so that its surface is precisely parallel to the slide. It is carefully wiped with a soft tissue to remove any surface dust, and then it is placed under the microscope. Here it can be checked whether the surface is suitably prepared to start the staining procedure, and also the initial photographs of the cross-section can be taken in visible and blue light. This image shows a cross-section of a Japanese lacquer coating in visible light, as seen through the microscope. As Asian lacquer coatings contain components that have a characteristic fluorescence under incident blue light, the light source and filter cubes are changed in the microscope so that the sample can be examined under fluorescent conditions. This image shows the same sample as before in blue light, where the multi-layered structure of the top lacquer layers and the foundation becomes even more apparent. In order to stain a cross-section with most of the histochemical stains, it is necessary to saturate the porous sample in the solvent of the stain to achieve saturation and to avoid penetration of the stain into the porous structure. Here, the sample cube had already been placed in the solvent bath. After 5 minutes of soaking in the solvent, it is removed with tweezers and dried with a soft tissue. As the cross-section of the sample might be slightly swollen and sensitive to mechanical action, any contact between tissue and the embedded sample surface is avoided. Staining with Amido Black requires to leave the cross-section sample in the staining bath for approximately 15 minutes. The sample surface is then rinsed with a 1% acetic acid solution until no further stain can be removed from the sample. Rinsing can actually be done in several ways. Either a squirt bottle is used, like it is shown here. Alternatively, the sample cube can be placed into small dishes with rinsing solution and gently moved in the liquid. With this latter method, the rinsing solution should be exchanged a couple of times. Again, the sample is carefully dried using some soft tissue paper. The staining result is now checked with a microscope and is shown in this picture. In blue light, protein stained with amido black would have appeared as very dark or almost black areas in the sample. These are clearly not present here. Here are all the four images that were taken of this sample so far. The top row shows the sample before staining, and the bottom row shows them after protein staining. Please note that the subtle darkening of the lower sample images derives from a previous staining for starch and is not a result of positive staining with amido black. To present you a positive staining result for proteins, these four images depict a Chinese lacquer sample before and after staining with amido black. The two images in the bottom row clearly show the blue and black appearance of the foundation layer, the fibrous layer, and the wood substrate in visible and blue light respectively. Staining for starch is undertaken with iodine potassium iodide, also known as Lugol solution. It is a very reliable agent to color starch within starch-containing material in dark blue-black, and even small amounts of this binder can be easily detected in cross-sections with this method. Staining starch does not require the sample cube to be pre-soaked in any solvent, so a drop of this staining solution is applied directly on the cross-section surface of the specimen. As the reaction of starch with iodine is almost instantaneous, exposure to the stain does not have to be very long. The stain is left on the sample for approximately 30 seconds before the excess of the solution can be wiped off again. The cross-section of the Japanese lacquer sample shown earlier now displays a lower foundation layer that contains a small amount of starch. The positive staining result can be clearly seen in visible but also in blue light under the microscope. In Japanese lacquer coatings, starch is a typical ingredient for these lower foundation layers, where it was often added to the Asian lacquer and clay powder mixture for optimizing its adhesion properties. Staining for oils and lipids can be undertaken with Sudan black and isopropanol. Here, the staining solution is transferred into the small staining dish. To prevent the evaporation of the solvent, the dish is covered with a glass slide. Then, several small dishes are filled with a mixture of ethanol and water. One of them serves as the soaking bath for saturating the sample with solvent prior to staining. This and the other dishes will also be later used for rinsing the stained sample, which is the alternative method for rinsing a sample mentioned earlier. As before with a protein staining, the sample cube is placed in the saturation bath for about 5 minutes. It is useful to set a timer so that the sample is not kept in the bath for longer than necessary, as some of the binding medium may be slowly dissolved. After 5 minutes, the sample can be removed from the bath, the excess solvent is wiped off, and the cross-section cube is placed in the stain, where it is left for 5 to 15 minutes. Alternatively to using a squirt bottle for rinsing, the sample is now placed in several dishes filled with the same solvent that was used for the saturation process before staining. The cross-section is gently moved with some tweezers and rinsed in these solutions for as long as it is giving off some stain. If the rinsing solution becomes coloured, it should be replaced by a fresh one. With Sudan black staining, it is very important that both the saturation process and the rinsing are done very thoroughly, as otherwise a meaningful interpretation of the results may become very difficult, if not impossible. After staining for oils, the Japanese lacquer sample showed a very regular staining in the foundation layers, which both have taken up a deep blue-black colour. If viewed under blue light, the sample further shows that the very top layer, which was previously fluorescing in bright yellow, now is stained entirely black. This suggests that the top layer is an oil varnish rather than an Asian lacquer, which would not have taken up any staining agent. Viewing all four images from before and after staining next to each other clearly reveals the differences that are made visible by the staining process. Please note that the black staining seen around the entire sample is an interference of the Sudan black with a coating agent that was applied on the lacquer sample surface to protect it against resin infiltration prior to embedding. This coating is not part of the sample and should therefore be ignored during interpretation of the staining results. The Chinese lacquer sample gave similar results, whilst here, in addition to the foundation layers, the fibrous layer and the wood substrate also took up the stain in some areas. Hence, it can be assumed that all these layers contain some oil or lipids. A second method of staining oils is using Nile blue sulphate. The staining procedure is similar to that of Sudan black, but Nile blue has the advantage of producing staining results, which are often better visible. Also, the staining solution does not interfere so much with the coating agents that may have been used to protect the sample from resin infiltration during embedding. The only disadvantage of Nile blue is that it also colors proteins. Therefore, it can only give ambiguous results when used on its own. However, it is a very useful stain when used in combination with Amido black and Sudan black stains because it can help support staining results achieved with the other methods. Here is the Japanese lacquer sample as shown before, without staining and stained with Sudan black. If the top row is replaced by images taken after Nile blue sulphate staining, it is clearly visible that the Nile blue gives a similar result to the Sudan black, but without interfering with the coating agent as much as the Sudan black did. However, it should be noted that the top coating of the sample does also not appear to be stained by the Nile blue sulphate. Together with the negative staining results of the previous protein staining, it is suggested that the sample hence contains oil in the foundation layers, but no protein. In the Chinese lacquer sample, the Nile blue staining showed also positive results, but here it may indicate the presence of both protein and oil. This is suggested by the previously performed amido black staining, which had given an indication for the presence of protein medium.